Welcome back to this next video in which we are discussing the standard topology on Rn. Okay, so, in the previous video then, what we did is we motivated what we were trying to achieve with the standard topology on Rn. So for R1, R2 and R3, the standard topology is going to create a topological space which will mirror the structure of the one-dimensional, two-dimensional and three-dimensional continuums respectively. Okay, right. So what we're now going to do is we're going to have a look at the abstract, rigorous definition of the standard topology on Rn. And I want to stress that all we're going to need in order to define this is a few structural features of the real numbers. So we're going to need to understand that the real numbers has a field algebraic structure on it, so we can add and multiply any two real numbers together. And we're also going to need to understand that the real numbers has an order on it. Okay, but apart from that, that's all we're going to need in order to define the standard topology on Rn. Okay, so, to do this then, the first thing that we need to define is what is meant by a ball around an element of Rn of radius r. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to take some element of Rn, which I will denote by p here. Okay, so this is just going to be an element of Rn, and note we're back up to the abstract Rn, so the general Rn rather than R2 that we were working with before. So we're working in the general Rn now. So we'll have an element from the general Rn, which is just an n-tuple of real numbers, like so. Okay, and what we're going to now define is what is meant by the ball around this element in Rn of a certain radius. So what we're going to also need is a radius, and that's just going to be some real number that's greater than zero. Okay, so we'll pick some r that's greater than zero, and now what we're going to define then is what is meant by the ball of radius r around the point p in Rn. Okay, so b for ball, subscript r, which will tell us the radius, and then brackets p, which will tell us the point in Rn that we're actually going to have this ball around. Okay, so this is going to be a subset, fundamentally, of Rn, and it's going to be the subset that contains all elements of Rn such that a certain condition holds. So if I now write this out explicitly here, we're going to have an explicit expression for the set, which is going to be the ball of radius r around the point p. Okay, so the way we're going to define this then is it's going to be all the elements of Rn. Okay, and I'll write these out like so, x1 bar, x2 bar, all the way up to xn bar here. Okay, which are elements of Rn. So you're going to take all n-tuples in Rn such that a certain condition holds, and this is where we're going to need the fact that the real numbers has an addition and multiplication on it and an order on it. Okay, such that this complicated expression, which isn't actually that complicated, just looks complicated, the sum from I is equal to 1 to n of xi minus xi bar squared is less than r squared. Okay, now note, although this looks like something from geometry, it doesn't actually require any geometry in order to define this. All we need is the field algebraic structure of the real numbers and the order on the real numbers. That's all we need in order to define this ball around the point p of radius r. Okay, so let's just explore this expression a little bit more. Okay, so how can we explore this expression? Well, the best way to do it is get rid of the sigma and write it out explicitly what this is going to be. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to take x1 and we're going to minus x1 bar, which of course rigorously is just adding the additive inverse of x1 bar, and then we'll add that to x2 minus x2 bar squared, plus all the way up to xn minus xn bar squared. Okay, so what you're going to do then is you're going to go through all points in Rn, you're going to construct this expression. So you've got your point, capital little p here, which is x1, x2, all the way up to xn. What you're going to do is go through all points in Rn of this form, x1 bar, x2 bar, all the way up to xn bar, and you're going to work out what this expression is, and that's a purely algebraic thing to do. All you need to do that is the field algebraic structure of the real numbers. All we're doing is adding together real numbers and multiplying real numbers and then adding a bit more. Okay, it's just an algebraic expression, so there's nothing geometrical out there at all. It's just an algebraic expression. Okay? Then comes another property of the real numbers that we're going to require, which is the ordering property of the real numbers, because we're then going to say, and I want this to be less than r squared. So you work out this number in the real numbers, and if it's less than r squared, then you will put this point, x1 bar, x2 bar, all the way up to xn bar, into the ball of radius r around this point p. Okay, so that's the definition then of a ball around a point in Rn of radius r. Okay, and it just requires, as I said, it doesn't require any vector space structure on this set Rn. It doesn't require a geometrical structure on there. All it requires is that we understand something about the real numbers. Okay, right, so now what I'm going to do then is actually define the topology. Okay, so I'm going to define what subsets of Rn are we going to consider open sets? Which sets am I going to put in the topology tau? Okay, so, quite simply, U will be an element of my topology tau, which is going to be my standard topology now, if U satisfies the condition that for all elements of U, so if for all, what should I say, for all little u is an element of capital U, so little u is now going to be a point in Rn that's actually in this subset capital U here. So you take any element that's actually in our subset capital U, and it's going to be the case that for all u, there exists an r greater than zero such that the ball of radius r around this point u is completely contained within the set capital U. Okay, so this is, well, this looks a complicated definition, but it's actually nice. Okay, so we'll talk through this and we'll get some intuition for what this actually means. Okay, right, so u is going to be an element of the topology tau, so u is a subset of our set Rn here, if for any little u is in capital U. Okay, so let me draw a picture for this. So actually, I'll draw a picture and we'll have this representing our entire set Rn. So what we've now got is some subset U here of Rn. And now little u is an actual element of this subset capital U here. Okay, so we'll colour in the subset capital U in green here. So we've taken some element, little u, in here, and what we now need to be able to do is find some radius r. So I can vary my r. I can make r very, very small as I like, but it cannot go down to zero. It has to be greater than zero. It has to be positive. Okay, so I can make this radius as small as I like. But for some radius, if I make the radius small enough, it has to be the case that if I construct the ball around U of that radius, that has to be completely contained in the set capital U. So it has to be the case that if I make the ball small enough, that it will be completely contained in capital U. Okay, so, and that has to hold true for whatever elements of the subset capital U I actually pick. Okay, so for all elements in the subset capital U, it has to be the case that there exists a ball of some radius small enough around that is actually going to be completely contained within the subset capital U. That is how I'm going to define which subsets of my set Rn are actually going to be considered open sets, which ones are going to be put in the topology, the standard topology on Rn. Okay, now before we actually prove that this definition of a topology on Rn actually does obey the axioms of a topology, let's have a bit of intuition for what this means. Let's go back to our example of R2 here and actually see what does this mean in terms of R2 here. Okay, so let me go over the page. So I'll just redraw out my picture of R2 firstly. So remember, the intuitive picture of R2 is that we've associated all of the elements in this set. So I'll just draw out the set here. So R2 is the set of all pairs of real numbers, x1, x2. where the XIs are elements of the real numbers. Okay, so here's my symbolic R2. This is the real R2, of course. But the intuitive way, the way that we have to gain some intuition for this, is that we've associated all of these with points on the plane. Okay, so what we can think of is subsets of this being represented as subsets of the plane. And what I would like to do is get some intuition as to what these subsets which satisfy that criterion to go into the standard topology are actually going to look like on the plane. Okay, well, you might have seen this before in analysis. Okay, so these sets are going to look like sets that don't contain their boundary. And the way that we draw sets that don't contain their boundary is we draw their boundary dashed like so. Okay, so here, this might be a set, indeed this will be a set. This is representing a set of R2, these points. If we take all of these points and we take their symbols that represent them in R2 here, that will be a subset of R2, and indeed this will be one of these subsets that fulfills the criterion to be in the topology. And let me explain why. Okay, so I mean all of the points inside this dashed line, but not the points that are actually on the dashed line. Okay, now, the reason that this will actually fulfil that criterion is that if I take any point in here, then it will be some point like this, then hopefully you can agree that if I make the radius small enough, and I suppose actually I need to discuss what a ball will look like in terms of this before I can discuss this. So what do balls look like around points in our beautiful picture of R2 here? Okay, so what does the ball of a certain radius around this point, which we'll call little p here, actually look like in terms of our intuitive picture? Well, let's go back to the definition. It's all of the points in R2 that actually satisfy this criterion, and of course, this is the intuitive definition of how far away a point is in R2. Now, I know we haven't defined that, okay? We have not put on our abstract set here a notion of distance, okay? But our intuitive plane here does have a notion of distance, okay? So intuitively then, what these sets look like in the plane, even though we haven't defined this on our abstract mathematical set here, these are going to look like all the points that have a distance away from the point P less than R, is the intuition. So it will actually look like a little disk here. Okay, and the reason it's called a ball, of course, is that in R3, these will look like balls surrounding the point P. In R2, however, they look like disks. Okay, so intuitively then, we will be able to make our radius here small enough that that disk will be completely contained in here. Okay, always, because our point will not be on the boundary. Now, if our set did contain a piece of the boundary, so let's say it contained this point, then it wouldn't satisfy this criterion, because if I took a point that was on that bit of boundary, whatever size ball I take around that, I will always end up with points outside of the set. Okay, unless I actually made the ball's radius zero, but you can't do that. The radius has to be positive. So for any positive radius, you'll always end up with these points here in red that are outside of the set. Okay, so that's why it mustn't contain the boundary. But as long as you don't contain the boundary, as long as you have splodges like this on your plane that don't contain their boundary, then for any point in that set, you will be able to construct a little disk around it, a little ball of some radius around it that is completely contained in it. And that is what you have to satisfy in order to say that this set is going to be within our standard topology. So that's the intuitive picture now. Now, just to add a little bit more on here, it isn't necessary that these splodges, these subsets, are all as one splodge, basically, one dot here. I mean, our subset could have another portion over here, which doesn't contain its boundary as well. So the subset could be all of the portions that I've now denoted in orange here. It doesn't have to be connected. Okay, you can have separate splodges, and this is a perfectly valid subset of R2, okay? So we'll just, by which I mean, of course, you look at the symbols in here that represent those points, and that will be the subset of R2. Okay, so this as well will count. It will satisfy the definition in order to be in the standard topology. So these sets that are in the standard topology, they don't just have to be one dot. They can be another splodge as well. They can be separate splodges on the plane. Okay, so that's intuitively then what these sets that we will be putting into the standard topology actually look like for R2, and it's very easy to generalize this for R1 and R3, and then you can kind of imagine what it means in R4 and R5, etc., and Rn. Okay, so that's intuitively what this definition actually means. Okay, now back to the rigorous abstract stuff. Let's prove that with this definition, this set, the topology, which will contain all of these sets that satisfy that criterion, is actually going to satisfy the axioms of a topology. Okay, so this is the fun bit then. Axiom number one then, okay? Axiom number one says that the empty set and the entire set, which is Rn in this case, must be an element of the topology. Okay, so let's just verify that those two sets actually satisfy our criterion to be in this standard topology. So we'll start off with the empty set. So the empty set contains absolutely nothing, so a more stupid way of writing the empty set is like so. Okay, the set that contains absolutely nothing. Okay, so in order for a set to be in our standard topology, we have to check that for all points in the set that you can construct a ball of some radius around that point which is contained completely within the subset. Now there are no points in the empty set, so trivially we don't have to check anything, so it does trivially satisfy it because we don't have to check it for any points, and therefore it does satisfy it for all the points that are in it, which is nothing. Okay, so that's why the empty set trivially satisfies this complicated condition. The entire set then? Well, of course the entire set's going to satisfy that condition, because if you take any point in the entire set, you can construct a ball around that, of any radius in fact, and that ball of any radius you like will be in the entire set, okay? Because balls, after all, are just subsets of Rn, okay? So all balls that you can possibly construct around any element of Rn will be within Rn. So the entire set trivially satisfies this condition. Okay, so those two are easy. Now let's have a look at the more difficult axioms, but again, this is not difficult to prove. Okay, so axiom number two then, we want to prove that if we take two subsets that are in our topology, so we want to prove for all U1 and U2, which are open sets in our standard topology, okay, we want to show that if we intersect the two together, so U1 intersect U2, that that will also be in the topology. Okay, so how do we tackle this? Well, the way we tackle it is we just go to the definition. What does it mean for U1 intersect U2 to be in the topology tau? Well, it means that any point that's in here must have a ball around it of some radius that's also completely contained in here. Okay, so quite simply, let P be a point that's contained within U1 intersect U2. Okay, so I've just some point that's in that set. What I need to show is that I can find a ball of some radius around that point that is completely contained in this subset as well. Okay, well, what's my approach going to be for this? Well, what I'm given is that U1 and U2 are in the topology. Okay, so if P is an element of U1 intersect U2, what does that mean? It means that it's in both U1 and U2. So from this, I can easily conclude that P has to be in both of them. That's just the definition of the intersection of these two. It's the things that are in both of them. So if P is in there, it's in both of them. Okay, so I'll just underline that in a nice colour. So P is in U1 and P is in U2. But U1 and U2 are open sets in my standard topology, so they must satisfy this definition. I.e., there must be a ball of some radius, which I'll call R1 here, around the point P, which is completely contained within U1. And likewise for U2, there must be a ball of some radius, which I'll call R2 now, around the point P, which is completely contained in U2. Okay, so I must be able to find these balls of some radii around this point P that are contained in these two sets here, okay, just by definition, otherwise they wouldn't be in the topology. Now, what I can then quite simply do is say, okay, just take the smaller radius here. So take whichever one of these radii is smaller. Okay, so let's say it's R1. So let's say, imagine that R1 is smaller than R2. okay, or potentially equal to it. I mean, they could end up being identically equal to one another, but one of them is going to be less than or equal to the other, okay, always. Okay, so I'm just saying, okay, let it be R1. That's just arbitrary. Okay, then what of course is true is that the ball R1P is completely contained within the ball around P of radius R2, okay, because this is a less strict condition, this is a less strict condition than this, okay. In order to be in this one, the this sum that you construct here, which will be simple because it will only have two terms, it will only be this portion here, has to be less than or equal to R2 squared, whereas for this one, it has to be less than or equal to R1 squared. So if it's less than or equal to R1 squared, it will certainly be less than or equal to R2 squared. So indeed, this one will completely contain this one. Okay, so what we can therefore conclude is that the ball of ball around P of radius R1 will be completely contained within U2. So if this is contained in this, and this is contained in U2, then what we get is that the ball of radius R1 around the point P is completely contained in the set U2. But now we've got that this set here is contained in both U1 and U2, and what does that therefore imply? Well, it therefore implies that the ball of radius R1 around P is completely contained within U1 intersect U2, because remember, the definition of the intersection of U1 within U2 is all the things that are in both U1 and U2. I've said this entire set here is in both U1 and U2 now, and therefore it must be in the intersection of the two of them, and therefore I've now found a ball of a certain radius around my point P, which is completely contained in U1 intersect U2. So any point that you come up with in the intersection of U1 with U2, I can always construct you a ball around that point of some radius that will be completely contained within that set U1 intersect U2. Okay, so indeed, when you do intersect two open sets, according to this standard topology, you do end up with another open set according to this standard topology. Excellent. So that's axiom number two satisfied. Now axiom number three. Okay, so this says that if we union together, okay, so I'll put a big union sign, an arbitrary number of open sets, that we must also end up with another open set. Okay, so we want to prove once again that the union of an arbitrary number of open sets is going to satisfy the criterion to be in the standard topology. And to do that, of course, again, we have to prove that if you take an arbitrary point, little p, in this final answer subset here, that it will contain a ball around that point, little p, of some radius completely within it. Okay, so now let p be some arbitrary element in this massive great union over alpha of these open sets U alpha from our topology. Okay, what I now want to prove is that I can find some ball around the point p which will be completely contained within that set. Okay, so how am I going to do this? Well, if P is in this great big union of all of these sets from the topology, and I should just put that somewhere, U alpha are all from the topology tau. So if P is in this great big union, then what that implies is that P must be in at least one of these open sets here, okay, that's within the union. Otherwise, it wouldn't be within the union. Okay, so what I can say is this implies that P is in at least one of the open sets, and I'll call this open set UI, where I is now fixed, okay? So one of these open sets that you're unioning together here must contain P, okay? Otherwise it wouldn't end up in the entire union. So find some set in this union that actually does contain P. Now, because this is an open set, what I can instantly say is that there is some ball around P of some radius which is therefore completely contained within this open set UI. Just applying the fact that this is open, I can say that that is true. Now, of course, when you union together sets, you keep all the elements of the larger set Rn that are in all of these subsets. So you will keep all of the elements in this ball around the point P of radius r because you keep all of the points that are in ui. Okay, so everything that's in all of these subsets that you're unioning together here will be in the final union. Therefore, this thing, this entire ball here, must be in the entire union. So what I've now proven is that the ball of radius r around the point P will be contained in this massive great union over alpha of all these open sets u alpha. Okay, and that's exactly what I wanted to prove. So I've now proven that if you take a point within this final answer, the union of all of these open sets, the union will contain a ball of some radius around that point P, and therefore, since that was an arbitrary point P that I took, this final union of all these open sets will indeed be an open set. Okay, so it will be an element of the topology tau. So indeed, this abstract definition of the standard topology on Rn does indeed satisfy the axioms of a topological structure. Okay, it does indeed satisfy the structure of a topology. Okay, so you can equip then Rn with this topological structure, and you have then equipped Rn with the standard topology on Rn. Okay, so we've now therefore finished the definition of the standard topology on Rn. What I now want to do is try and return back to my initial motivation for defining this, the motivation that we were trying to capture the topological structure of the plane. And I want to discuss an informal intuition for R2 as to why the standard topology on R2 actually captures the intuitive notion that I want on R2. So let me go back up to my picture here. Okay, so we've got our set R2 here, and I've now defined this standard topology on R2, which contains all of these subsets which do not contain their boundary. So all of these subsets that look like orange. So this is a great big set containing subsets that look like what I've got coloured in orange there. So I just put that orange symbol there to denote a subset like that. So it's a huge great set of subsets of Rn. Okay, now, how then does this actually then equip R2 with a topological structure that was similar to the plane? Okay, so remember when we were discussing initially the reminder of topological spaces, and I gave you the informal intuition behind how you can go from having a topological structure like this, a topology, to actually connecting up the symbols in this set. Okay, and remember the way that we did it is we said, okay, I'll draw a little line between two elements of the set if it is the case that when one of them appears in a set that's in the topology, the other has to appear with it. So they only occur as a pair together in a set that is, when they appear in sets that are in the topology. Okay, they never appear in isolation. Okay, so how then does that correspond to R2 with this standard topology on? Well, remember what we were trying to do is we were trying to connect points, or rather symbols, that are representing infinitesimally close points. And I claim that this will do that, okay, because if you imagine which points in R2, so let's actually take a point, so let's take this point P again. Okay, and if I want to ask which points am I actually going to draw lines between P and other points in this set R2, and again, of course, I mean the symbols that are representing the points in the plane here. Okay, so if I ask which symbols am I actually going to draw lines between, so let's say I've got the symbol that represents P in here, and I'm going to ask which symbols am I actually going to draw a line between P and those symbols? Well, it'll have to only be the points that are infinitesimally close to it, because if you imagine, I can construct these sets that are in the topology arbitrarily small. I can put arbitrarily small subsets that don't contain their boundary around this point P. Okay, so I'm going to lose the possibility of connecting it to any other points than those that are so close that you can't ever get a subset that's so small that it doesn't contain both of them. And that, intuitively, is the infinitesimally close points. As I say, this isn't rigorous, this is an informal intuition. Okay, so I'm claiming that the only points that I'm going to end up connecting to P, so let's say this is the point P and we've now zoomed in to an infinitesimal scale, I claim that the only points that I'm going to end up connecting to P are those that are infinitesimally close to it, because I will always be able to construct open sets around this point P that contain the point P that are arbitrarily small, and therefore I lose the possibility of connecting any other points to P other than those that are infinitesimally close and are so close that you can't possibly ever construct an open set around that point that are that is that small that it doesn't contain them. Okay, now of course that isn't a rigorous argument at all. That doesn't stand up in rigorous mathematics. Okay, in rigorous mathematics, any point, you'll always be able to find an open set that's small enough around P that doesn't contain that point. Okay, but intuitively, that's how this does actually capture that concept. Okay, right. So I will end there, and in the next video what we'll go on to is defining the concept of a continuous function between two topological spaces. Okay, now in this next video on the continuous functions, we will see how this informal intuition for what a topological space is actually got defined on it, this notion of having little connections between the points in the topological space, how that actually really helps us to motivate the definition of continuity. So although this isn't rigorous, it is a really helpful informal intuition to have of what a topological space actually is, that it's a set with little connections between points in that set. Okay, right, so we'll call it there.